This is the Thermalright Frozen Warframe SE ARGB V2. It's an all-in-one liquid cooler that pairs plenty of RGB and a rotatable LCD with an affordable price. And interestingly enough, it's also the second version of the Frozen Warframe we've actually looked at lately. With how impressed we were with the Frozen Warframe Pro, we needed to know if this special edition AIO with its blingy RGB is it worthy of a special place in your gaming PC's heart? We're gonna answer that question and more right here, right now on Robitech. After a word from our sponsors, us. This video is brought to you by our official Robitech build mat. If you've been watching the channel for a while, you'll probably recognize it. We love these things. They're super thick and durable, and they're absolutely huge in size, measuring at 5.5 millimeters thick and 24 by 48 inches wide. This one that we have right here, man, this has been in the studio for like 4 years, and it's still holding up great, no problem. We've also included all sorts of useful graphics showing different PC form factor sizes, including schematic diagrams and connectors you'll encounter probably during your PC build. Not to mention, there's plenty of open space for screw and tool organization. We designed it like this so no matter what skill level of builder you are, it could be a helpful tool for pretty much everyone. Now, you can find these build mounts for sale on our Newegg store, and it's a great way to support us directly if you enjoy the content we make. Thank you so much for your support, and let's get back to the video. We've been using Thermalright products for a while now at Robitech, and for a very good reason. From what we've seen, Thermalright has made it their mission to pull features from higher price points and make them more accessible to everyday PC builders. Though, spoiler alert, they might be branching out a little, and we might have had the chance to get a hands-on with their first truly premium liquid cooler. Stay tuned for a future video on that one. But today, we're looking at the Frozen Warframe SE V2. It's another example of Thermalright's accessibility approach to the PC DIY market. It's packed with RGB, it has a detachable LCD screen, and it has some smart design features that make installation easier than ever. But with an asking price and spec list so similar to the Frozen Warframe Pro, where exactly does the V2 land when it comes to performance? And with Thermalright already having so many options around this price or less that look very similar on paper, how meaningful are some of the design changes that they implemented really? Well, like a thin layer of ice on a deep lake, and as Optimus Prime says, there's more than meets the eye here, so let's dive into the details. Knowing that Thermalright tends to court budget-conscious builders, let's get into the pricing. In a bit of a surprising move, the Frozen Warframe V2 is only available in a single 360mm size and will run you right around $100 on Amazon. We've seen it for even less if you can catch it on sale. It was listed at only $80 when we prepared this video, and again, since then we've had Fantastic and Amazon Prime, so you know it is possible to score a deal if you're patient. We wouldn't be surprised to see more sizes available in the future since 240 and 360mm offerings have been kind of the baseline of most Thermalright coolers so far, but for now the only options are white and black to fit your build at 360mm. Unlike the Thermalright Aqua Elite and Frozen Note, which you can actually check out our Aqua Elite review right here, those AIOs hovered closer to $50 to $60. The Frozen Warframe 2, it sits in a much more competitive space and competes with coolers from well-known brands like Cooler Master and Corsair, but even more directly with popular budget-conscious performers like the Lianli GA2 Lite, which is our most performant sub-$100 AIO, and the Arctic Liquid Freezer 3 Pro. But remember, the Frozen Warframe SE does have an LCD, which tends to cost more than other brands. In the $75 to $125 price range, Thermalright has a stranglehold on the budget LCD cooler market, which basically means that you're either getting Thermalright for an LCD, or you're gonna go with some lesser known brands like Vever and PC Cooler if you don't wanna pay more. And I don't even know if I said Vever right. That being said though, we'll be looking at AIOs from those other brands really soon. So again, make sure you stay tuned, like and subscribe so you can see those when they come out. Now let's move over to compatibility. The Frozen Warframe V2 offers relatively generous support for both AMD and Intel. Over at Team Blue, it offers support from everything from LGA 1156 to LGA 1851. For AMD, it supports AM4 and AM5, which seems like less, but since AMD has supported its sockets for so long, that means that coverage for every Ryzen CPU since they introduced it back in 2017. So no matter which platform you choose, the installation process is super beginner friendly. On both platforms, the Frozen Warframe SE uses a support bracket with two threaded inserts to fasten the pump head down. This means that you're not using any hooks on AMD. Yes. Now those thread inserts act as like, they're like guideposts that keep things aligned, simplifying the installation process for both new and experienced builders alike. While we're focused on the pump, let's zoom in at exactly what the Frozen Warframe SE-V2's pump actually brings to the table. Thermarite doesn't disclose who makes the SE's pump, but they do share that it's able to spin up to 3000 RPM to quickly sweep heat away. The coolant is then funneled through two braided cables up to a radiator that is entirely standard in size. So if your case is designed to support a 360 millimeter radiator, you shouldn't have any risk of scraped knuckles during installation. Now we're gonna talk more about the detachable screen here very shortly, but it's worth noting that there are several wires that obviously come from the pump that need to be managed. One of them, you basically need to connect to a motherboard header. One is to connect the screen over USB, and then there's a SATA power connector. We're not even sure why the screen couldn't just be powered by USB, but hey, SATA, and that makes nobody SATA to use, right? So moving on to fans. The Frozen Warframe SE's 320 millimeter fans are kind of traced with RGB on their faces and light up on the sides while leaving the blades dark, giving it a stylish but kind of restrained RGB look. The fans are daisy chained and come pre-installed on the radiator, which saves you some installation time and some cable management. Like the radiator, there aren't any surprises with the dimensions of the fans. They measure 25 millimeters thick and have a top speed of 2,000 RPM. They move marginally less air than the Frozen Warframe Pro we looked at last time, rating at 68.9 CFM of airflow. Air pressure though, that took a bit of a bigger hit, coming in at 2.21 millimeter H2O compared to the Pro's 2.62 millimeter H2O. You might be like, Roby, what? But who cares, right? Well, actually, that's probably the most important stat is that's the static pressure and how much power the fans have to push air through, which cools the actual radiator. Overall, those specs for fans are pretty typical for a budget AIO. They're not the worst we've seen, but they're not the best either. If you are looking for an AIO with better fan specs and honestly better cooling for only a few dollars more, the Li & Li Galahad 2 Lite offers almost twice the air pressure and more radiator thickness for the cooling. So depending on what you're after, it may be worth shopping around if you're looking for the absolute best spec for the price. Now, while we're on the topic of the screen, because we were talking about managing that earlier, let's take a moment and look at exactly what you're getting here. The display area has actually shrunk slightly from the Frozen Warframe Pro and measures 2 by 2 inches, with a resolution of the screen being 320 by 240. It's reasonably bright and has a high enough pixel density to look good. And using the TRCC software, you can customize its handful of built-in information displays, or you can upload your own GIFs. The software is just for the screen though, so if you're looking to customize fan speeds or performance modes, you'll need to turn to your motherboard if your BIOS supports it, which would be surprising if they didn't, but we wanted to note that. Now the screen is detachable and it can be rotated to match the orientation of the GIF you're trying to display. Now the LCD has one quirk you don't see on higher end coolers, and that's that it doesn't draw the information from the motherboard in real time. Instead, everything it's displaying comes from Windows, which means there's a slight delay for information readouts like your CPU temperature. So if you're using it all the time, you're just staring at it, you're just trying to monitor it, and you just want to know the instant it overheats, could be too late. So boom, your whole PC could be gone. So keeping up with cool is important because that's the name of the game for any AIO, especially one that kind of puts Frozen right in the name. So with that in mind, let's get to performance. As a reminder, we test all of our AIOs in match systems and conditions for both Intel and AMD to keep things as consistent as possible. You can check the details on the screen for the exact specs. Starting with idle temperatures on our Intel test bench. The Frozen Warframe SE-V2 averaged between 27 and 28 degrees Celsius with a slight lean towards 27. This average put it in the cooler third of our results, 1 degree warmer than the Li & Li Galahad 2 Lite and a close match to the Be Quiet Silent Loop 3. In our CPU load test, well, the temperature jumped to an average of just over 81 degrees Celsius. This positioned it towards the cooler side of our tested AIOs, beating out the community favorite Arctic Liquid Freezer 3 ARGB by a degree and maintaining its position in our roster of AIOs. Moving on to Cinebench, the Frozen Warframe SE-V2 loses some ground here. Here, higher is actually better, and with a score of 33,279, that puts it in the bottom third of our results, flipping what we saw in the other tests. But how much power does it need to achieve those results? Under load, it averaged 244 watts. That's the second highest we've recorded, and a full 11 watts higher than the Galahad 2 Lite. So it's working hard for a Cinebench score here, especially when we consider that the Trikes Panorama SE drew 1 watt less and found itself a few positions higher in the Cinebench chart. Moving on to our gaming benchmarks, the Frozen Warframe SE-V2 averaged just above 53 degrees Celsius. Compared to our other tested AIOs, that's not exactly frozen behavior, but it's squarely in the middle of the road for gaming temps, which leaves plenty of headroom room for our 14700K running at full speed. Let's turn over to AMD. We recorded an average temp between 38 and 39 degrees Celsius at idle, while it's leaning a bit more towards 39 if we were rounding numbers. This positioned it near AIOs like the Fantex Glacier 1 M25 Gen 2 and the Dark Flash DH360. Under full CPU load, the Frozen Warframe SE averaged a bit below 87 degrees. While it does lose some ground against its competitors compared to how it performed on our Intel system, it managed to be middle of the road, if not slightly better, when there's no load applied. As for Cinebench performance, the Frozen Warframe SE flips things entirely compared to Intel with a third place score of 19,692. This placed it about 60 points off from the number one spot held by the Lianli Galahad 2 Lite. Now, power draw under load has been consistent across all of our AIOs on AMD, with all of them averaging around 144 watts, and the Frozen Warframe SE V2 is no different, with an average power draw of 144.54 watts. Technically, it's higher, but I mean, come on, with that margin, who's counting? I mean, except us, obviously. Now, gaming on AMD was definitely on the warmer side with an average temp just shy of 57 degrees. It loses ground compared to what we saw on Intel, but still kept our 7700X cool enough to comfortably game without any fear of thermal throttling. Now, power draw was also on the hungrier side, averaging just under 80 watts, but it's in good company with AIOs like the Liquid Freezer 3 ARGB Pro and the Glacier 1 M24 Gen 2. Now, registering heat is one thing, but getting rid of heat requires the fans to spin up. So let's break down how noisy the Frozen Warframe SE V2 actually is. While gaming, we recorded noise levels of around 48 decibels, making it one of the quietest coolers we've actually tested. Under full load with fans running at 100%, things got significantly louder and that average jumped to 62 decibels. Now that we know what the Frozen Warframe V2 has to offer, let's look at the value. Here's how the math actually breaks down. We start by dividing the MSRP by the difference between CPU thermal max, which is 100 degrees Celsius, and the average CPU temperature under load. This gives us a dollars per degree of cooling value, which we can then score and compare. In this case, the lower the score, the better. These numbers are based on the data we collected from our Intel benchmarks and MSRP pricing. Now, the values obviously change over time with sales and everything else, but you have the equation if you want a more up-to-date value and you want to do a comparison yourself based off of non-MSRP prices. So using these calculations, the Frozen Warframe SE V2 comes in with a value score of 5.3, which places it alongside other budget AIOs like the Montek Hyperflow ARGB and the Fantex Glacier 1 360 M25. But it is a bit behind the Frozen Warframe Pro or the Lianli Galahad 2 Lite that you're probably going to be comparing this directly against. So with all of that in mind, where do we land with the Thermalright Frozen Warframe SE ARGB V2? At $100, Thermalright is positioning this in an especially competitive space in the market. But if you want a decent screen at that price, Thermalright is probably the brand you're going to be looking at because you have so many options in that price bracket. And since so many of its options offer similar levels of performance to our eyes, it comes down to how much you connect with the looks and the value of the detachable screen. To be clear, there are reasons outside of the screen and aesthetics that we like this AIO, one of the top being that it's friendlier AIO for novice and experienced builders to use. The mounting system is hard to make mistakes with, and the use of guideposts is just plain convenient. Users obviously will still need to be mindful when they're tightening the pump down evenly, but the design really kind of helps with that. There's also the simplicity of the SE's pre-installed daisy chain fans that are absolutely worthy of highlight, especially if you struggle with installing fans the right way on radiators like me. But if you want to change the direction their hoses go on, well, yeah, you're just gonna have to deal with it. So when we look at the whole picture, there's a clear emphasis with the Frozen Warframe V2 to let you spend less time worrying about getting it installed and more time to actually enjoying what it adds to your system. So while it isn't a thermal chart topper, is it going to put your system at risk or lead to thermal throttling? No. For the most part, we saw this AIO keep things comparatively on the cooler side of our test when you look at the spectrum of performance across all of the competing AIOs. Of course, there's room for improvement like there usually is, but the Frozen Warframe SE V2 feels like a safe bet and an easy way to keep your CPU cool enough while still offering good looks and customization potential that punches above its class. So that's what we think about the Frozen Warframe SE ARGB V2, but now it's time to hear from you. How cool is cool enough for you? And would you pay $100 for the Frozen Warframe if it meant picking up a screen and the style? And does a pump head LCD even matter to you? Let me know all of that down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, make sure you slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so that you get a notification each and every time we post a video like this right here in Robitech. And if you want to continue the conversation, maybe you want to talk more about this AIO or get answers to your questions, head over to our Discord server, discord.gg/Robitech. You'll meet lots and lots of people, and you know what? You might just make a friend. Also, follow us on @Robitech on all the other social media. Thank you for making it this far in the video. We look forward to seeing you on the next one.